Hello and welcome to Reboot Theater. I'm your host, the Invisible Man. Well, here it is. The one you've all been waiting for. The culmination of 11 years of storytelling. The conclusion of an entire arc told over the course of 22 movies. A movie so popular, it became the highest grossing film of all time. This is the one, the only, Avengers Endgame! You know why you're here, and you already know what happened, so I'm done with exposition. We got a lot to get through, so let's jump right in. After the events of Infinity War, Iron Man and Nebula are trying to find their way back to Earth, but they're having a little trouble getting there because their ship ran out of fuel and they're almost out of oxygen. So instead, they pass the time by playing tabletop football.
And you've won. Congratulations.
Yes, they spend their days trying to distract themselves from the sad reality of their inevitable deaths. How's that for foreshadowing? But just when it looks totally hopeless... Did somebody call AAA? Captain Marvel tells the pair back to Earth, even though she had no way of knowing where in the universe they were, and the remaining Avengers regroup at HQ to discuss how to undo the snap.
What's wrong with him?
He thinks he failed, which of course he did, but you know, there's a lot of that going around, ain't there?
Honestly, until this exact second, I thought you were Build-A-Bear.
Maybe I am.
Thank you, Bradley Cooper, for bringing some much-needed comic relief to this. Nebula tells the gang that she knows where Thanos went, to a garden on a distant planet. So they plan to travel there to get the stones back so they can unsnap everyone. Well, would you look at that? They listen to the fans!
You should have aimed for the head. Nah, the odd is good, huh? Oh, poop.
But their perfect plan turns out not so perfect, as all the stones are gone.
We use the stones to destroy the stones. The work is done. It always will be. I am inevitable.
What did you do?
I went for the head.
Okay, Thor, I want you to keep that in mind, okay? For later in the movie. When the time comes, just do the exact same thing one more time. Okay? Great. So without the stones, they can't bring back all their loved ones. And over the next 5 years, they all try to move on with life. Tony and Pepper have a daughter, Thor becomes... the Big Lebowski, and Steve leads a support group for people who lost their spouses in the snap.
I went in the ice in 45 right after I met the love of my life. You gotta move on. You gotta move on.
Oh, he'll move on? With her niece?! Literally 3 days after she died! Yeah! And Hawkeye, who for some reason wasn't even in the last Avengers movie, lost his family in the snap, then became so wrecked with pain he became a vigilante known as Ronin. Not to be confused with Ronan, the king of dance battles.
Me versus you! It's on!
But just when it looks like things are hopeless, a happy accident releases Ant-Man from the Quantum Realm! Then he learns, while he was trapped in another dimension, half the world got snapped and he was assumed to be one of the victims. So he goes to the only people that can help him.
Hi, is anyone home? This is, Scott Lang.
Ant-Man explains that he was in the Quantum Realm for 5 years, but from his perspective, it only lasted 5 hours. Well, thank you! Finally, we get an explanation on how Janet survived in there with no food or water for so long! Then he suggests they use the Quantum Realm to go back in time and retrieve the Infinity Stones before they were destroyed. They ask Iron Man for help, but he says no. So they go to the second smartest guy on the team. What is that abomination?! No, not that one. This one! Oh my god! Oh my god! I have no problem with Bruce Banner. And I have no problem with the Hulk. But putting the two together? Holy uncanny valley, that is creepy! So after the last movie, when Banner couldn't get the Hulk to come out, he spent a few months in the lab and came up with a compromise. But I'm personally not a fan of Professor Hulk.
Hulk out! Damn.
Oh, why? Why?! You did not just make the Hulk dab! I know you did not just do that! No! No! Hulk is not the kind of guy that wears shirts and hosts your mom's book club. He's the kind of guy that does this. And this. And yes, even this.
I am a god, you dull creature. And I will not be bullied by that.
Puny god.
The reason he's an interesting character is because he's the Hyde to Dr. Banner's Jekyll. But now you have Jekyll's voice coming out of Hyde's mouth, and it's just so wrong.
Say green.
Green.
Green. Did you get that?
Fortunately, I know this is just a temporary thing, and the Savage Hulk will eventually be back. Right? Right? Please say right! We just got the Hulk back! We can't lose him again!
I think I liked you better either of the other ways.
You and me both, sister. So they perform a test run by sending Scott back in time 1 week.
Guys, this doesn't feel right.
Uh-oh, I sense some hijinks coming on! Whoa, Mr. Rogers really let himself go. Better send him back to the land of make-believe.
It's Scott.
As a baby.
He'll grow.
That's it. That's the line. That is the funniest thing in all of these movies. And that's saying a lot. Oh, man. You know what? I'm gonna start using this. Yeah, the next time someone tells me I'm too young for something, I'm gonna use this line. What do you mean I can't run for president? You're not 35. I'll grow!
Somebody peed my pants.
Oh, thank God.
Thank God somebody peed his pants.
I don't know if it was baby me or old me. Or just me.
And a warm thank you to Paul Rudd. Thanks for keeping the mood light. Meanwhile, Iron Man keeps thinking about how he left Spider-Man not feeling so good. So he changes his mind about helping the gang and lets go of his grudge against Cap.
Pause for product placement. And we're good.
Turns out resentment is corrosive, and I hate it.
Me too.
You know, 99% of all people could learn something from these two. It's okay to admit when you're wrong. In fact, I have only the highest respect for people who do admit it. Because when you pretend you're in the right, even when you know you're in the wrong, that's a sign of cowardice. So bravo, boys! Way to put your differences aside and play nice.
Instead of pushing Lang through time, you might have wound up pushing time through Lang. It's tricky. Regardless, I fixed it. A fully functioning time-space GPS.
So they gather the old team back together to travel to the past. But if you think this will be easy, guess again. Because the writers randomly decided to make cause and effect non-existent.
Changing the past doesn't change the future.
Look, think about it. If you travel to the past, that past becomes your future. And your former present becomes the past.
Exactly.
What? Are you really gonna pretend this makes sense?
Exactly.
No, not exactly. This makes no sense to me no matter how many times I watch it.
Exactly.
Stop it. Stop saying that word.
Exactly.
No! Let's just move on. I do understand why the writers did it this way, because they didn't want to retcon any of the old movies, and it would also allow them to kill people from the past without the risk of a paradox. And let's face it, if they could change the past, then it would have been this simple.
You should have gone for the head.
I'll keep that in mind.
Or better yet, just go back, steal one of the stones, and Thanos won't have all six. Then he can't perform the snap. But because that wouldn't have been very cinematic, here's how the time travel logic works instead. When going back in time, the heroes create an alternate timeline the moment they get there, and any changes they make only occur in that alternate timeline. Then, when they return to the present, they return to the same timeline they originally left, because they are tethered to that timeline. This is shown when Hawkeye does the test run, and he gets forcibly yanked back to the present. And even if they make a pit stop along the way, like, say, to pick up more pin particles, they first get pulled back to their original timeline, and then come out at a different point in time, creating another alternate timeline. At least, that's my guess. Logic is really weird in this movie. The team determines where and when they will retrieve each stone, and then divide up into teams to retrieve them. Since they only have enough Pym particles for one round trip each, and Hank Pym isn't around to make them anymore, they only have one chance to succeed at their mission.
Get the stones, get them back.
Avengers assemble! The stones.
See you in a minute.
Ooh, that hurts. That hurts on the second viewing. First, New York City of 2012. Tony, Steve, Scott, and Bruce travel there to get the Space Stone, Mind Stone, and Time Stone. And I must admit, this is my favorite part of the movie. Not just because it gives me massive nostalgia, but also because... Oh yeah! Hulk smash! To blend in, Cap suggests that future Hulk smash a few things along the way. Insert Jeopardy theme here. Okay, the real Hulk would kick your buttocks into next week! This is so lame! Wait a second. Are you telling me the Ancient One was in New York at the time of this battle, and she didn't think to help fight? The Earth could have used a sorceress protecting it, wouldn't you say?
I'm looking for Doctor Strange.
You're about 5 years too early. What do you want from him?
That, actually.
Ah, I'm afraid not.
Sorry, but I wasn't asking.
So Hulk tries taking the stone by force, but she pushes his astral form right out of his body.
Let's start over, shall we?
Now, this I really don't get. Shouldn't the spirit of a human body be naked because only your body is a living thing? Why is his consciousness wearing clothes? And it would be one thing if they were clothes he had on, but he's not even wearing that outfit! He doesn't even have a shirt on! Where did that come from? Meanwhile, Rocket and Thor go to Asgard in 2013 to get the ether from Jane Foster. While Nat, Clint, Rhodey, and Nebula go to 2014 to get the Power Stone and Soul Stone.
A long way from Budapest.
What? No traveling tunes? Ah, well, I'm adding some. Awesome mix! But there's a catch. Because there are now two nebulas in the same year, their calls get crossed, so to speak. This causes past Nebula to see the memories of future Nebula, which tips off Thanos to their plan.
They're not trying to stop something I'm going to do in our time. We're trying to undo something I've already done in theirs.
Back in New York, Cap gets Loki's scepter by infiltrating the strike team in the elevator. Whew, that had to be stressful, considering what happened last time. But this time, he has the advantage of paying them lip service.
I just got a call from the secretary. I'm gonna be running point on the scepter.
Hail Hydra.
And they hand it over, no questions asked. Ha, idiot terrorists. Meanwhile, Ant-Man gives past Stark a heart attack so future Stark can steal the Tesseract. Which almost works, until it doesn't.
No! Stairs!
Don't even ask. Then Loki grabs the cube, opens the portal, and escapes. Top-notch security detail. Next time your job is to watch a prisoner, make sure you watch the prisoner! And when Cap sees someone who looks like him, he assumes it's Loki in disguise.
My way down to coordinate search and rescue.
I mean, honestly, how do you keep your food
shut up?
Oh, finally we get an explanation on that! I always figured he had that muzzle on because he talked too much. Now we finally know why! Then we get a brief battle of Cap versus Cap, followed by the scene we should have gotten in BVS.
Bucky is alive!
Why did you say that name? What? Why did you say- Ow! This is how it should have gone. Cap is taken aback by this, but he doesn't instantly become best friends with his imposter! Hulk tries to convince the Ancient One to give him the Time Stone, and she educates him on how time travel actually works.
Remove one of the stones, and that flow splits. In this new branch reality, our world would be overrun.
We can erase it, because once we're done with the stones, we can return each one to its own timeline at the moment it was taken. It never left.
Okay, I think this is a good time for another lesson on this movie's logic. If you go back and change the past, you create an alternate timeline. Then, when you return to your own time, the alternate timeline still exists, separate from your own. However, you can still go back to that alternate timeline by traveling back to the exact moment you left. I think this is getting really weird now. Banner tells the Ancient One that Doctor Strange willingly gave up the stone, and she realizes he must have had a good reason. So she begrudgingly gives Bruce the Time Stone, entrusting him to bring it back.
I'm counting on you, Bruce. We all are.
So with no Tesseract, the Avengers have failed their mission. But then Iron Man comes up with a creative solution.
You got it. There's another way to retake the Tesseract and acquire new particles.
So Tony and Steve head to New Jersey in the year 1970, where they obtain the Space Stone as well as more Pym particles.
This is Captain Stevens from shipping. We have a package for you.
Bring it up.
Sir, the box is glowing, and to be honest, some of our male guys aren't feeling that great.
Excuse me, out of the way!
Oh, Hank, why must you always buy the cheap uranium? Meanwhile, back in 2014, Hawkeye and Black Widow arrive on Vormir to get the Soul Stone. But as we all know, this stone requires a sacrifice.
In order to take the stone, you must lose that which you love. A soul for a soul.
The only problem is, the two of them disagree on who should take the leap.
I tell my family I love him.
You tell him yourself. Let me go.
No. No, 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 no! Come on! Why couldn't it have been Hawkeye? His death would have meant so much more! And here's why. After the snap, his family was killed, and he was willing to do anything to bring them back. And if he was willing to sacrifice his own life to bring his family back, that would have been the ultimate selfless act. It would have completed his arc, and they would have missed him, and they would have given him the proper funeral he deserved. As opposed to Black Widow, who has no spouse or kids, and kills herself for selfish reasons. The only reason she jumps is because she can't live without Clint, and that taints the sacrifice. It doesn't mean as much when the motivations are corrupt. But of course, because Black Widow's more popular than Hawkeye, they gave her the death scene because it would have been more heartbreaking to the fans. No! That's not the way you tell a story! You don't just kill off fan favorites to get a rise out of people! You're supposed to give it a purpose! So Natasha sacrifices herself so Clint can get the Soul Stone. And is it just me, or does she kind of look joyful that she's about to die? Well, nice knowing ya. Geronimo! Ow! Meanwhile, Nebula and Rhodey succeed at getting the Power Stone, and they return home. Only it doesn't go that smoothly. But we'll come back to that. With all the stones collected, they construct a new gauntlet, and Hulk brings back everyone Thanos snapped.
Bruce!
Honey. Honey. I think it worked.
Think again.
Thanos blows the entire building to rubble and somehow doesn't kill anyone. No, really. Zero casualties.
Bullshit.
So you're probably wondering how Thanos got back to the present day, right? Well, you see, right before she could travel back, Nebula got incapacitated and captured by Thanos. Then he pulled a switcheroo with 2014 Nebula and sent her back to the present instead. Once there, evil Nebula opened a time portal to let Thanos and all his forces through.
So this is the future. Well done.
Okay, time travel lesson number 3! Even if you have only one batch of Pym particles left, and you couldn't have possibly left them in the past because you needed to use those to get home, you can still open a time portal to a moment in the past where you once were, even though that's an alternate timeline and not the same version of 2014, and you can let as many people as you want come to the future, even though you have to shrink down to enter the portal, and Thanos didn't have any Kim particles of his own. You know, I'm starting to think these writers are just making it up as they go. Then 2014, Thanos tells Tony, Steve, and Thor what his new plan is.
I thought by eliminating half of life, the other half would thrive. But you've shown me that's impossible. I will shred this universe down to its last atom. And then create a new one, teeming with life.
Born out of blood.
They'll never know it, because you won't be alive to tell them.
And go for the head! And go for the head! Come on, you rehearsed this earlier, remember? How are you still not going for the head? Well, apparently Thor lost his edge over those last 5 years, because drinking beer and playing video games all day is apparently unhealthy. Wow, that explains so much. But before Thanos can kill Thor in the most ironic way possible... Captain America lifts Mjolnir!
I knew it.
If you've been paying attention, they foreshadowed this way back in Age of Ultron. And now, for the first time, Cap wields the hammer! Ooh, that looked really cool. Let's see that again. Cap actually holds his own against Thanos, but it's no use. Not only does he break Cap's unbreakable shield, he also brought with him an entire army in his ship.
In all my years of conquest, it was never personal. But I'll tell you now, what I'm about to do to your stubborn, annoying little planet, I'm gonna enjoy it very, very much.
But just when it all looks really hopeless...
Captain Sam, can you hear me? On your left.
Oh, yes, he did. Oh, yes, he did! Remember this?
On your left. On your left.
Don't say it. Don't you say it.
On your left.
Come on!
It all comes around full circle, doesn't it? And all the Avengers who got snapped come back to finish the job they started 5 years ago. And yes, this is a sight to behold. This is exactly what we all came to see. Every Avenger in the universe united against Thanos. And Thanos doesn't scare easily. But when he sees the army of heroes he's going up against, he looks a bit worried.
Avengers!
Here it comes!
Assemble.
This is amazing. Absolutely incredible! This battle is so epic, so insane, has so much awesome jam-packed into it, it's impossible not to geek out over it. Just talking about it makes me sound like a little kid playing with action figures. Okay, so Hawkeye has the gauntlet, and then he passes it off to Black Panther, who uses his vibranium to blast the bad guys away, like, and then Ebony Maw tries to grab it, but Spider-Man grabs it instead, and the bad guys try to steal it from him, but then he uses instant kill on all of them. Pew, pew, pew! And then Pepper comes to his rescue, because her superhero name is Rescue, and she rescues him, and then he jumps onto Valkyrie's flying horse.
Wait a second, dude. Where did she get a flying horse? I don't remember her having a flying horse.
Well, she just does, okay? And then they both fly away like, phew! And then over here, Scarlet Witch wants revenge on Thanos because he killed Vision in the last movie and she was in love with him. And then she's like, you broke my heart. Now I'm gonna break you! Rah! Even though this Thanos hasn't done it yet, but he will. And then he says, rain fire! And then he tries to kill the good guys, but he ends up killing the bad guys! And then Spider-Man falls off the horse. Ah! And then back up arise. It's Captain Marvel! Yes! Captain Marvel's here! Time to end this battle once and for all! So once Marvel shows up, Thanos is getting really scared. Especially when she blasts through his entire ship like it was made of tissue paper!
Oh, but I just paid it off.
And now it's a simple matter of killing Thanos. Well, at least she's going for the head. That's something. But come on, the same girl who just did this? Can't do the same thing to Thanos' head? Here's how this should have gone.
I am
inevitable.
And rip his arm off! And throw him across the field! Well, do something other than playing tug of war! Oh yeah, this is much better. Yeah, stand there, doing nothing, instead of blasting him in the face. Don't even think about trying to kill him. Definitely don't do that. So after trying to melt his fingers off, so he can't snap, I guess, just kill him! Thanos grabs the Power Stone out of the gauntlet and punches Marvel away. Why are we undercutting Captain Marvel? She's been built up as the most powerful Avenger. Even more powerful than Thor and Hulk. So powerful, Fury only called her when an apocalyptic event happened. And now you make her this underpowered? What is wrong with these writers? She should be able to waste Thanos with one punch. Then Doctor Strange reminds Iron Man that there's only one scenario where they win. And Tony understands what he must do.
I am inevitable.
Surprise, motherfucker!
I am Iron Man.
And with that one snap, all of Thanos' forces are turned to dust. In a parallel to the previous movie, he sits down, as the battle is now over. But this time, he sits down in defeat. However, because Iron Man wasn't a superhuman, he couldn't survive the energy of all six stones coursing through his veins. And as sad as it is, Tony Stark dies. Now that is proof that he had a heart. You were the greatest, Tony. You were the greatest of all of us. And what a fitting way to go out. The last words he says in the first movie,
I am Iron Man,
are the same last words he says in this movie.
I am Iron Man.
Yes, you are. And nobody can replace you. The same man who started it all, ended it all. Then we get a funeral for the savior of the universe, and all the Avengers come out to pay their respects. Wait a second. What is Mantis doing? Everyone else is standing in reverence, paying their respects, and Mantis looks like she's humming a song in her head. Show some respect, would you? If not for that, man, you'd still be dust right now! Then the only thing left to do is return the stones back to where they came from.
And returning in 3, 2, 1.
But then Cap doesn't come back, and they discover he took the long way home.
Cap?
Hi, Sam.
After returning the stones, Steve Rogers went back to the 1940s and lived his life with Peggy Carter. And he finally got that dance. Okay, time for one last time travel lesson. If you go back in time, you'll live life in an alternate timeline. We have well established that already, which means old Cap would not have appeared here because he couldn't have been in the original timeline and... Okay, you know what? I'm done. I am sick of trying to find patterns in randomness. This movie has no coherent logic. You need PIM particles to travel through time. Whoops, no you don't. Just open up a portal. Oh, but at least any changes you make in the past don't affect the present. Unless you want them to, then of course you can go back in time and become a part of history. Oh, so many plot holes. Such lazy writing. Guys, the kiss method goes a long way, alright? Loki's invading? Call the Avengers! Ronan's gonna destroy a planet? Call the Guardians! Make the story simple, but the characters complex! That's what will keep the audience coming back for more! But when you use time travel as a gimmick like this, it doesn't feel like there are any real stakes. Only whatever stakes the writers were in the mood for. But gaps in logic aside, I am really glad Cap returned home. This completes his arc, just as Tony's arc was completed.
I shouldn't be alive, unless it was for a reason.
The day he escaped from those terrorists, he cheated death. And that debt was repaid when he gave his life to save everyone else's. You know, they probably could have used the Time Stone to put Humpty Dumpty back together again, just like Thanos did with Vision in the last movie. But oh well. Likewise, Steve's life, his friends, his family, his time period, was stolen from him when he was frozen for 70 years. And now his life has finally been returned, as he finally gets reunited with Peggy. And that was Avengers Endgame! Is it the greatest movie ever? Well, I wouldn't go that far. But is it worth a watch? Yeah, I'd say so. Obviously, any Marvel fan is going to see this. That's an absolute given. But if you're not familiar with these movies already, I think you might be a tad confused here. Hell, I've seen all the movies that led up to this, and even I was confused by this film! In fact, the more of these movies I see, I start to notice a pattern. It's no longer about making one good movie anymore. It's not about making a film that anyone can enjoy, even if you haven't seen the others that came before it. It used to be that way, which is why Phase 1 is still my favorite in this series. If you take any one of those movies at random, with one exception, any one of them is a fun film that focuses on establishing the characters in just that one movie. The fans who already know the characters will like it, but there's also no learning curve, so anyone new to the series will probably enjoy it too. But lately it seems like Marvel's priorities have shifted. Now the main objective isn't making a good movie, but making sure it can be tied into a bigger universe later on. For instance, Spider-Man's movie? What's it even about him? It was all about Tony Stark! The villain was angry at Tony Stark, the creator of the spider suit was Tony Stark, Peter kept doing everything he could to please Tony Stark, Peter got saved by Tony Stark, and got an assist from Tony Stark, and it seemed as though Peter couldn't even go two sentences without referencing Tony Stark!
I mean, what if Mrs. Stark needs me or something, or I don't know, something that goes down?
I mean, Mrs. Stark knows because he made my suit, but that's it!
Mrs. Stark.
Thank you, Mrs. Stark.
We get it! You like Tony Stark! But we already know who he is! How about we learn who you are? Huh? Who is Spider-Man? What makes this particular version different from the others? What are your likes? Dislikes? What do you want to be when you grow up? These are all questions that never got answered, because the filmmakers are too busy setting up the next movie to focus on the one they were making. And I'm not sure if this was intentional, but they even acknowledged this problem at one point.
Please, this is all I have. I'm nothing without this suit.
If you're nothing without this suit, then you shouldn't have it.
Bingo! That's the point I'm trying to make here! It's not about the suit, it's about the guy wearing it! You can't have Spider-Man without the man! But lately, these writers seem to have forgotten that once well-known rule. Characters come first, powers come second. You can't have a movie about just powers, you'd have people using them!
The suit has power, the man harnesses that power.
Whosoever holds this hammer, if he be worthy, shall possess the power of Thor.
That's what makes a film interesting. The people in it. They drive the story and make the movie possible. And if the characters are interesting, the film is interesting. But when you cut the screen time for character development because you're too busy trying to cram in longer fight scenes or more time travel gimmicks, it's going to fall flat. It may entertain people on the first viewing, not so much on the second. It doesn't have the same staying power as, say, a billionaire playboy learning the value of human life, or a smug prince born into luxury finally learning humility, or a band of misfits coming together as a team and becoming better people because of it. These are interesting stories about interesting people. That's why we keep coming back to them. But this movie didn't even give the characters time to grieve. Yes, we gave Iron Man a proper funeral, but what about Black Widow? She gave up her life so her friends could get the Soul Stone. And instead of giving her a proper funeral, even after the fact, they just say, oh well, so sad. Well, on with the story. Yet another reason I think it should have been Hawkeye, but... The point is, this movie was good, but I feel it could have been a lot better. I'm the Invisible Man, and when there's an okay sequel, I got it covered.